Hello students, good morning everyone. So today we are going to start the depression in the freezing point. So this is one of the colligative property. So before we start this, let us briefly recap what we discussed in the previous classes. So in colligative properties, what are colligative properties? The properties of the solutions which depends only on the number of particles of the solute irrespective of their nature. That properties we call it as what? Colligative properties. Why? Because few properties which depends only on the nature and few properties which depends only on the number. So those properties which depends only on the number of particles, that particles we call it as what? Colligative properties. Under this colligative properties, relative lowering of vapor pressure, depression in the freezing point, elevation of boiling point, and osmosis and osmotic pressure. Total four properties we discuss under this colligative properties. So in the earlier classes, already we discussed relative lowering of vapor pressure, elevation of boiling point. Two properties are already over. So now we are going to continue the third property, that is what? Depression in freezing point. Yes, what is freezing point? So what is exactly the meaning of freezing? So freezing is nothing but the process of conversion of liquids into solids by decreasing the temperature is called what? Freezing. Okay, once again, the process of conversion of liquid substances into solids by decreasing the temperature is called what? Freezing. Best example, you take the water. If you decrease the water, if you decrease the temperature of water to zero or below 0 degrees Celsius, slowly water becomes what? Ice. And this process of conversion of liquid water into solid ice, we call it as what? Freezing. Now, what is freezing point? Freezing point is nothing but the temperature at which the solid form of the substance, a solid form of the liquid getting separating from liquids is called what? Freezing point. So once again, the temperature at which the solid form of the liquid getting separating from liquids is called what? Freezing point. So if you take the water ice, if you decrease the temperature of water to 0 degrees Celsius, so when the temperature reaches 0 degrees Celsius, slowly the water, liquid water, slowly become converting into ice, and that ice is trying to separating from liquid. Okay, and at what temperature slowly that ice is forming, that temperature we call it as what? Freezing point. Okay, now as per the Raoult's law, and the Raoult's law is one of the important law. So Raoult's law differentiated the substances into two types: volatile substances, non-volatile substances. What are volatile substances? The substances which are having very high vapor pressure, that substances we call it as what? Volatile substances or volatile liquids. Best example, you take the petrol. If you keep the petrol in an open vessel, okay, so it is highly volatile, means it's having high tendency to getting vaporized. Because of high vapors, because of more number of vapors, their vapor pressure also will be more. So that substances which are having very high vapor pressure, that substances we call it as what? Volatile substances. Coming to next one, non-volatile substances. The substances which are having very less vapor pressure, that substances we call it as what? Non-volatile substances. According to Raoult's law, when you add a non-volatile substance to a pure solvent, the vapor pressure of the solution decreases. So once again, according to the Raoult's law, when we add a non-volatile substance to the pure solvent, the vapor pressure of the solution decreases. If the vapor pressure decreases, what happened to the freezing point? What is the relation between the freezing point and vapor pressure? Let us see. So first of all, freezing point, I am representing the freezing point with TF. TF represents what? Freezing temperature or freezing point. Yes, what is a freezing point? Because already we discussed the temperature at which the solid form of liquid it separates from liquid is called freezing point. For example, water. For water, freezing point is 0 degrees Celsius. That is equal to 273 kelvins. Likewise, for every solvent, they are having their respective freezing points. And we can also give one more definition for the freezing point. What is that? The temperature at which the vapor pressure of the liquid is equal to the vapor pressure of the solid, that temperature also we call it as what? Freezing point. Okay, so the temperature at which the vapor pressure of liquid is equal to the vapor pressure of solid. Okay, that temperature also we call it as what? Freezing point. Always remember that at this freezing point, both liquid substance and a solid substance, they both are at equilibrium. This indicates what? Equilibrium. Okay, at the freezing point, always the liquids and solids are always be at equilibrium. Okay, now when they are at equilibrium, when the solids and liquids are at equilibrium, the vapor pressure of the liquid is equal to vapor pressure of solid. So we can write Vp of liquid is equal to Vp of solid. Okay, at equilibrium, if you add a non-volatile solute, usually the non-volatile substances are having low vapor pressure. If you add a non-volatile solute to this equilibrium mixture, what happened? The vapor pressure of the resulting solution obviously will decrease. So the addition of non-volatile substance, the addition of non-volatile solute to this equilibrium mixture decreases the vapor pressure of the solution. If the vapor pressure of the solution decreases, automatically what happens? The freezing temperature also decreases. So finally, the addition of non-volatile solute decreases what? Freezing point. And that decreasing the freezing point of the solvent by adding a non-volatile solute is called what? Depression in the freezing point. So what is a depression in the freezing point? The decreasing the freezing point, so TF, decreasing the freezing point of solvent by adding a non-volatile solute. Decreasing the freezing point of the solvent by adding a non-volatile solute is called depression in freezing point, delta TF. Okay, so delta TF is equal to freezing point of pure solvent, TF naught. This indicates what? Pure solvent. Freezing point of pure solvent minus TFS, freezing point of solution. Why? Because after addition of solute to the solvent, okay, what happens? The freezing point of the solution decreases. That is why TF naught minus TFS, this difference we call it as what? Depression in the freezing point. And this you can easily understand if we explain this by using the graphs. Now let us draw a graph by using the vapor pressures of the solvent and solution. When we draw the graph between vapor pressure, P stands for what? Vapor pressure. T stands for temperature. Here the temperatures we are taking in Kelvin scale. Okay, now the curve AB indicates what? This is a vapor pressure temperature relations of pure solid, a frozen solid. Okay, now you take the pure solvent, the curve BC represents what? The curve BC represents is a pure solvent, vapor pressure of pure solvent that I am representing with the P naught. Pure solvent is P naught. Now what we said, if you add a non-volatile solute to the pure solvent, what happens? The vapor pressure of the solution decreases. Now I am drawing the vapor pressure curve of solution. So curve DE indicates what? It's a solution, PS. And I told you what is the exact definition of freezing point. The temperature at which the vapor pressure of the solvent or solution is equal to the vapor pressure of solid. That temperature we call it as what? Freezing point. Now, at what temperature, see this is the temperature axis. At what temperature the vapor pressure of the pure solvent is equal to vapor pressure of the solid at this point? So draw the line here. So this temperature, this is what? TF, freezing point of solvent, TF naught, right? The temperature at this temperature, at the point B, the vapor pressure of this solvent and the vapor pressure of the solid are equal. So that is why this point we call it as what? TF naught, freezing point of solvent, pure solvent. Now, at point D, the vapor pressure curve of solution is equal to the vapor pressure of solid are equal. So at this point, at this temperature, both are equal. This temperature indicates what? TFS. Now tell me, this is from 0 to it will increases from in x-axis. So after the addition of non-volatile solute to the solvent, what happens? The freezing point decreases. So that delta TF, depression in the freezing point, is equal to always higher value minus lower value. Among these two, which is higher? TF naught will be higher. That is freezing point of pure solvent is higher. So delta TF is equal to TF naught minus TFS. Okay, depression in the freezing point is equal to TF naught minus TFS. Okay, and next one, as we discussed already in the elevation of boiling point, as per the experimental data, they said delta TF, depression in the freezing point, is directly proportional to molality of the solution. So what is M? M stands for molality, not molarity, molality. Okay, delta TF is directly proportional to what? Molality. So if you remove this proportionality constant, delta TF is equal to KF into molality. KF into molality. What is KF here? KF is nothing but molar depression constant. KF is what? Molar depression constant. Molar depression constant. It is also we call it as cryoscopic constant. Cryoscopic constant. Always remember that we represent the KF, and if you take the water, for water at 273 kelvins, the KF value is always be equal to 1.86. And the units of KF is very very important. Units of cryoscopic constant, we always be expressing Kelvin, kg, mole inverse. Kelvin, kg, mole inverse. So what is the KF value for pure water at 273 kelvins? 1.86 Kelvin, kg, mole inverse. Okay, so how you define the KF? Just imagine delta TF is equal to KF into M. M stands for molality. If M becomes 1, if M is equal to 1, then KF is equal to delta TF. No? So how you define the KF? KF is nothing but KF, is nothing but it's the difference or the depression in freezing point of molar solution. Depression in freezing point of molar solution is called what? Kf. So if m is equal to 1, Kf is equal to delta df. So Kf is nothing but delta df for molar solution. Molar means one molality. Okay, since we know that molality is equal to, what is the formula? Number of moles of solute present in 1 kg of solvent. Okay, 1 kg of solvent. That definition we call it as what? Molarity. So as per the definition, molarity is equal to number of moles of the solute by kg of solvent, means weight of solvent, N by W naught. N by W naught. Here W naught means weight of solvent. It is always be expressed in kgs. Or if you wanted to convert these grams into 1000, you keep 1000 in the numerator. So, and the number of moles is equal to weight of solute by molar mass of solute. Okay, substitute that, then molality is equal to weight of solute by molar mass of solute into weight of solvent, WS by MS into W naught. Here W naught, we if you take it in kg, suppose if you take weight of solvent in grams, then molality is equal to weight of solute in 1000 by molar mass of solute in weight of solvent in grams. So this is a formula for molality. Okay, now substitute this molality formula here. So if we substitute this molality formula in this delta TF formula, then delta TF is equal to KF into WS into 1000 by MS into W naught. So from this formula, if we wanted to calculate MS, molar mass of solute, you bring this side, delta DF to that side. Therefore, molar mass of unknown solute is equal to KF into WS into 1000 by delta TF into weight of solvent in grams. So by using this, we can calculate the molar mass of unknown solute. Not only this one, colligative property is the main application of colligative properties. By using the colligative properties, we can determine the molecular masses of unknown solute present in the solution. So by using this method, we can calculate the molar mass of unknown solute present in the solution. And this method of determination of molecular mass by using depression in the freezing point, okay, that method we call it as what? RAST method. So what we call this method? RAST method. And the determination of molar masses of unknown solute by using elevation of boiling point. Elevation of boiling point. What we call that? The Cottrell's method. Previously, by using elevation of boiling point, if we calculate the molecular masses, that is called Cottrell's method. By using depression in the freezing point, if you determine the molecular masses, that is called RAST method. Okay, so next one, osmosis and osmotic pressure. The fourth colligative property is very important colligative property, that is called osmosis and osmotic pressure. So before we discuss osmotic pressure, let us discuss what is exact meaning of osmosis. You know, diffusion of gases. What is the diffusion of gases? The spontaneous flow of gases. Spontaneous flow of gases from high pressure region to low pressure region is called what? Diffusion. Okay, that's one of the unique behavior of gases. They can uniformly distribute to whole throughout the volume. Okay, because of that behavior, they spontaneously moving from high pressure region to low pressure region, or else high concentration region to low concentration region. But osmosis is a unique behavior of solvent, not solute. Yes, what is exact meaning of osmosis? Osmosis is nothing but the spontaneous flow of solvent molecules. Which molecules? Solvent molecules from solvent to solution or low concentration region to high concentration region. And that spontaneous flow we call it as what? Osmosis. Okay, once again, osmosis is nothing but the spontaneous flow of solvent molecules from low concentration region to high concentration region, or solvent to solution, through semi-permeable membrane, SPM. SPM stands for what? Semi-permeable membrane. So that spontaneous flow of solvent molecules, we call it as what? Osmosis. Okay, this you can easily understand if you take a small example. I have taken a resin. This is resin. And I kept this resin in pure water. This is pure water. So if you check the concentration inside the resin and outside the resin, inside the resin there was a high concentration. Compared to outside, inside is what? High concentration. And outside is what? Low concentration. And resins means usually they are having SPM, semi-permeable membrane. So when you keep this resin in the water, what happened? If there was an osmosis, flow of solvent molecules from where to where? From low concentration region to high concentration. So here, outside is low concentration, inside is what? High concentration. Generally, water will move from outside to inside. Okay, here water is moving from outside to inside. So because of flow of water inside, what happened? The size of this resin will increase. Okay, the size will bulge. So this inflow of water we call it as what? Endosmosis. Okay, now the same in reverse. Now you take this raised resin. Okay, now transfer this resin into another beaker. In that beaker, I have taken NaCl solution, high concentrated NaCl solution. Now, when you check the concentrations inside and outside, inside concentration is low compared to outside. Why? Because we have taken high concentrated NaCl solution. Now, from where to where the solvent molecules will move? Now, it's reverse. It will move from inside to outside. The flow of water from inside to outside. So this, because of outflow of water, the size of the resin will decrease. And this outflow of water, or outflow of solvent molecules, we call it as what? Exosmosis. This is endosmosis. Endosmosis is nothing but inflow of water. Exosmosis means what? Outflow of water. Now I think you get an idea what is the exact meaning of osmosis. It's nothing but the spontaneous flow of solvent molecule. Here, in this case, only solvents molecules only moving, not solute molecules. So the spontaneous flow of solvent molecule from low concentration to high concentration through semi-permeable membrane. Yes, now what is a semi-permeable membrane? What is the role of semi-permeable membrane? If you take the SPM, semi-permeable membrane, it's a unique membrane, special membrane. It allows only solvent molecules, not solute molecules. Okay, that special membrane we call it as what? Semi-permeable membrane. Then you may get the doubt, from where we can get this SPM? How can we make this SPM? Yes. Usually, the membranes of animals, some animal bladders. For example, if you take pig's bladder. Okay, pig bladder. Or else, egg membrane, parchment paper, and some artificially prepared, that is a cupric ferrocyanide, calcium phosphate, so etc. These all can act as an semi-permeable membrane, and they allows the solvent molecules only in one direction. It allows only solvent molecules, not solute molecules. Remember that. So this is called what? Osmosis. Now let us move to the osmotic pressure. Our topic is osmotic pressure, not osmosis. To understand that osmotic pressure, you should know about osmosis. Now what is osmotic pressure? Osmotic pressure. So we usually represent this osmotic pressure with pi, in sometimes with P also, don't be confused. Okay, pi generally osmotic pressure. Again, P means normal pressure will come, but it's an osmotic pressure, that's why we represent with pi. What is the exact meaning of pressure? Simple logic. If you understand this osmosis phenomena, you can understand the osmotic pressure. Yes, what is osmotic pressure? See here, the solvent molecules are moving inside or outside, right? Whatever it may be the direction. With what pressure the solvent molecules are moving in or out? So the pressure by which the osmosis is taking place, that pressure we call it as what? Osmotic pressure. Okay, so the pressure by which the osmosis takes place is called osmotic pressure. It's a simple definition, right? But in textbook generally they give the definitions in complicated. Let us see the definition given in textbook. So according to the to understand this, let us take two beakers. And both beakers are arranged with a piston, frictionless pistons. They can push, or they can apply the pressure on it. And these two are interconnected with a inner pipe. And here they arrange SPM. Here, this is what? SPM. Okay. Now, in one beaker, they have taken completely pure water. In another beaker, they have taken highly concentrated NaCl solution. So this is a pure water beaker, this is NaCl solution. Now initially they have taken equal volumes of both. Okay, 1 liter of pure water, 1 liter of NaCl they have taken. Now what happened? When they connected, when these two beakers have been connected, what will happen? It will start the osmosis. If the osmosis starts, now tell me, from where to where the solvent molecules will move? Always solvent molecules are moving from low concentration region to high concentration region through SPM. This is SPM, it allows only solvent molecules. So this is the low concentration and this is what? High concentration. So the water is moving from this direction, from water beaker to NaCl beaker. After some time, what will happen? Slowly, what happened? The level of solution in the second beaker will slowly increases, and here the volume of the first beaker will decreases, right? Okay, so to stop this osmosis, with how much of pressure required? The pressure required to resist the flow of water from water beaker to NaCl beaker, that pressure we call it as what? Osmotic pressure. So suppose if you don't apply the pressure, water is moving from this beaker to this beaker. If you apply the pressure on it, okay, so it is this applied pressure resisting, stopping the flow of water from water beaker to NaCl beaker, and that applied pressure we call it as what? Osmotic pressure. Okay, so here the definition, second definition is the pressure required, external pressure. The external pressure required to prevent the flow of solvent molecules from solvent to solution, or low concentrated solution to high concentrated solution. This pressure, this external pressure required, we call it as what? Osmotic pressure. So we represent this with pi. Remember that. Okay. Now, in this osmotic pressure, the scientist Van't Hoff's given some mathematical relations by considering these solutions as gases. Why? Because dilute solutions, they considered as what? Gases only. He considered, Van't Hoff considered, all dilute solutions are like gases. If they are like gases, so the gas laws, all the gas laws are also applicable to dilute solutions also. So he applied the gas laws onto this dilute solutions. So let us look at the mathematical relations given by the Van't Hoff's equation. So as we already discussed, Van't Hoff, he considered all dilute solutions as gases and apply the gas laws on these dilute solutions. So if you apply the Boyle's law, so that is what Van't Hoff's Boyle's law. Van't Hoff's Boyle's law. According to Van't Hoff's Boyle's law, the osmotic pressure, not pressure, osmotic pressure of dilute solutions is directly proportional to concentration at constant temperature. We know Boyle's law. What is Boyle's law? According to Boyle's law, pressure is inversely proportional to volume. Then how it will be pi directly proportional to concentration? Since we know that concentration is nothing but what? N by V, na? Concentration and volume both are inversely proportional. So in the place of pi proportional to C, what we can write? Pi is proportional to 1 by V. According to Boyle's law, pressure and volume both are inversely proportional at a constant temperature. So applied, na? So this is equation number 1. This is Van't Hoff's Boyle's law. According to Van't Hoff's Boyle's law, osmotic pressure of the dilute solutions directly proportional to the concentration of the solution. If it is directly proportional to concentration, then concentration is inversely proportional to volume. Why? Because concentration C is nothing but N by V. Substitute, then pi is proportional to 1 by V. Next one, according to Van't Hoff's Charles law, Van't Hoff's Charles law. What is the Charles law? Pressure is directly proportional to temperature, or volume are directly proportional to temperature. Here, osmotic pressure is directly proportional to temperature at constant concentration. If the concentration was constant, osmotic pressure is directly proportional to temperature. This is equation number 2. Now, adding 1 and 2. By adding equations 1 and 2, what we can write? Pi is proportional to C and T. It's proportional to C now, and it's directly proportional to T. We can write pi is proportional to Ct, or else pi is proportional to T by V. Pi is proportional to T by V. Or else nt by v. Why? Because concentration is nothing but n by v, na? So pi is proportional to nt by v. You remove this proportionality. If you remove the proportionality, we should add a proportionality constant. So pi, see, I am taking this one. Pi is proportional to nt by v. Pi is proportional to nt by v. Now remove this proportionality. Pi is equal to NST by V. So you may get that out. What is S? Solution constant. It is same as like gas constant. Gas constant we represent with the R. Here it is applying for solution. That is why instead of gas constant I am using solution constant. And the value of solution constant and gas constant remains the same. R value is equal to 8.314, 0.0821, 2 calories, all the values are same. Solution constant to gas constant to both are same. Don't be confused. So pi is equal to NST by V. Bring V to this set. Pi V is equal to NST. Pi V is equal to NST, where pi is nothing but what? Osmotic pressure. V is volume. N is equal to number of moles, S is equal to solution constant, T is equal to what? Temperature. If N is equal to 1, if number of moles is 1, then it becomes what? Pi V is equal to ST. Pi V is equal to ST. Clear? So this is about osmotic pressure. And one more thing, you bring V to this set, or else pi is equal to NST by V, na? What we can write? From this equation, pi is equal to NST by V. Since N by V is nothing but what? Ratio between the number of moles to the volume, we call it as concentration. So pi is equal to CST. These are the three important formulas. Pi V is equal to NST. Pi V is equal to ST for one mole. Pi is equal to CST. Okay, and one more formula from this we can write. N is equal to what? Number of moles. Number of moles is nothing but ratio between the weight to the molar mass. Since N is equal to weight of solute by molar mass of solute, right? Okay, I am writing W by M. Now substitute this N value here. Then pi V is equal to WST by M. Then, but we want molar mass, na? All colligative properties we are using to determine what? Molecular mass. Bring molecular mass to this side, pi V to that side. Then, molecular mass is equal to WST by pi V. By using this formula, we can calculate molecular mass of unknown solute. Okay, so this is about the osmosis and osmotic pressure. Now, let us see few important terms and the formulas that we are getting. This is very useful for solving the objective questions. In osmotic pressure, what are the formulas that we got? The first formula, pi V is equal to NST, right? Pi V is equal to NST. Next one, you bring V to this set, pi is equal to NST by V, right? Since N by V is nothing but what? Concentration. So third formula, pi is equal to CST. C stands for what? Concentration. Pi is equal to CST. And one more formula, in the place of N, use W by M. Then pi V is equal to WST by M. From that, pi is equal to WST by MV. The fifth formula. Next one. Isotonic solutions. So these are the formulas we got. This is enough. Now we discuss what are isotonic solutions, hypotonic solutions, and hypertonic solutions. Isotonic solutions, hypotonic solutions, and hypertonic solutions. First of all, isotonic solutions. What are isotonic solutions? If a pair of solutions, or if two solutions, one solution, solution A and solution B, if these two solutions, both solutions osmotic pressures are same, the solutions whose osmotic pressures are same, that solutions we called as what? Isotonic solution. The name itself, iso means same. Okay, isotonic solutions means the two solutions whose osmotic pressures are same, then that solutions we call it as what? Isotonic solutions. Okay, here pi 1 is equal to pi 2. Pi 1 is equal to pi 2. Next one, hypotonic solutions. Hypotonic solutions. What is a hypo? Hypo means lesser. The solutions whose osmotic pressure is lesser. Okay, the solution whose osmotic pressure is lesser, that solution we call it as what? Hypotonic solution. So whose osmotic pi value is less. Why pi value is less? Okay, as we know, in this all, pi is directly proportional to concentration. No? If the concentration is more, pi value also more. But here pi value less means their concentration is lesser. So generally, low concentrated solutions are generally expressing low osmotic pressure, and that solutions we call it as what? Hypotonic solutions. Next one, hypertonic solutions. Hypertonic. Hyper means higher. So the solutions whose osmotic pressure is very high, okay, that solutions we call it as what? Hypertonic solutions. Why their osmotic pressure is very high? Because their concentration is high. Usually, high concentrated solutions are expressing higher osmotic pressure, so called hypertonic solutions. Okay, so based upon the osmotic pressure values, the solutions are of three types: isotonic, hypotonic, hypertonic. Isotonic means the solutions whose osmotic pressure values are remains same. Hypotonic means low concentrated solutions. That means they generally having very less osmotic pressure. Hypertonic means that solutions are having very high osmotic pressure. Generally, high concentrated solutions are acting as what? Hypertonic solutions. Okay, so remaining topic is what? Abnormal molecular masses. And what is reverse osmosis? What is Van 't Hoff's factor, I value? Okay, remaining all we will discuss in the next video. Okay, until then, take care. Bye bye.